So this is a Fitbit for whales. It's basically a smartwatch that measures every flipper stroke, every movement, every little thing the whale does. And it is terribly expensive. So much so that we have to order one a year or more in advance just to get it. We attach it to the whale with suction cups. Why? Because we've decided that this whale is worth protecting. Unless we know where it is, where it's going, and how it behaves, we can't really protect it. Now, we protect things all the time. Buildings, works of art, landscapes, and animals. And we usually protect things for one of three reasons. Our health is one reason. We protect natural habitats because it makes our air and our water cleaner, safer. For example, we protect the Amazon for lots of reasons. It's got incredible biodiversity and all that. But it also, its trees absorb carbon dioxide and produce oxygen, contributing to global air quality. Another reason we protect things is for the economy. Places like the Grand Canyon or Yellowstone National Park generate millions in tourism revenue. And finally, we protect things for legacy. The Mona Lisa is a work of art we've decided that our grandkids' grandkids should get to see simply because it's beautiful and culturally important. Now, whatever we protect, protecting that thing is oftentimes pretty straightforward. We can put a fence around it, we can designate a landmark, or store treasure behind glass. The Grand Canyon isn't moving, the Mona Lisa stays on her wall, and the Amazon remains rooted where it's been for millennia. So these things are a little straightforward, in my view, and simple to protect. So this is me. I'm a marine biologist, and that's me trying to put a satellite tag on a fish the size of a school bus. And if there's one thing I've learned in my career, it's this. The ocean is dynamic. The ocean changes on scales that are hard to wrap our heads around. It's changing at millions of years. It's changing at hundreds of years. But also, it's changing hourly, sometimes within minutes. Ask any fisherman, and they'll tell you, some days, fish are just boiling at the surface 1 minute and gone the next. A whale can travel thousands of miles across international boundaries just to find a spot to feed. And an oil spill can spread with shifting currents. So when we try and protect something in the ocean by drawing a fence around it, that's all well and good. But the reality is everything inside, outside, and around that fence is constantly changing. And that's the problem. Now there are a lot of good reasons to protect ocean features and creatures. Our food supply, our economy, and our future are tied to its survival. But how do you protect something that changes that quickly, that dramatically? Well, today I'm going to share with you the surprising ways that space technology can help us better protect the ocean, better track animals, and ensure our future. So what's space got to do with the ocean? Well, 8 years ago, I was commuting 3 hours every day to my job outside here in Washington, D.C. And I'm sitting in traffic, and I hear something on the radio about small satellites and how they're so accessible that even high school students are able to launch them with NASA. Small satellites have three great attributes. First, they're built to an open standard. This is huge. Open standards mean anybody can contribute and use them. Open standards for web coding mean that you can choose whatever browser you want, whether it's Safari, Chrome, or Edge, and the web page will still load properly. Open standards spur innovation and creativity by lowering the barriers to entry. Second, small satellites, you can guess by their name, are small, only about the size of a coffee cup sometimes. Imagine that, a satellite is in space right now, the size of a venti pumpkin spice latte. Because of their small size, they're also relatively inexpensive to launch. We can put them amongst the spare space and other payload missions and send them to orbit easily that way. They're so small that we can launch dozens at a time for a reasonable cost. So I'm sitting in traffic, and I hear the forecasted growth of the small satellite industry expecting to be 18,000 in orbit by 2030. And my brain went, wait, this could be a solution to the coverage problem. You see, we need widespread coverage to ensure that we're able to track animals well. Immediately, in my excitement, I sent a message to NASA. Now keep in mind, there are tens of thousands of people that work for NASA. I sent a message to their general inbox. Amazingly, someone actually got back to me. And I said, you know, hey, I'm Jake, can we work together? I track animals, I'm a marine scientist at the Department of Interior. Can we work together to get better coverage for a reduced cost? And someone amazingly got back to me from the small satellite program. And they said, yeah, and we began to get to work. But quickly, a new problem appeared, the accuracy problem. You see, widespread coverage is only as good as the accuracy of the tracking system. We were stumped. We didn't know what to do. So we launched a crowdsourcing challenge. Crowdsourcing allows you to fail cheaply, but also solicit a wide range of potential solutions. We wanted to cover as wide of a range as possible of people to solicit ideas. But in doing so, it leaves you vulnerable to get some really crazy ideas. For example, one was, just tell whales to use a cell phone and they'll tell you where they are. Legit suggestion. But we also got multiple good suggestions. Not complete, not a full solution, but that advanced the state of animal telemetry science. One of those was something called time of arrival, and that was the big breakthrough. But before I tell you what time of arrival is, you have to understand how we were tracking animals up until then. So in the 1980s, emerging technology made it possible for us to take a satellite transmitter and attach it to an animal and see where it goes. But there were a couple flaws with this technology. A significant one being that the location could be off by up to 2 kilometers. That's 20 football fields. It's the length of the Las Vegas Strip. Imagine if you just landed in Vegas and went to collect your bags, and someone at the baggage claim told you your bags were somewhere on the Vegas Strip. You wouldn't say thank you. You'd be like, no, buddy, my bags are lost. For example, I do a lot of work on the Caribbean island of Dominica, studying hawksbill turtles, the adults of which are about the size of a 3-year-old child. But the island is so small, and the tracking radius is so large, that if I was looking at the data to help inform a protected area, I wouldn't know if we should do it in the Atlantic Ocean or the Caribbean Sea. Plus, this technology, these tags, are so big that we can't attach them to 68% of vertebrates, leaving huge swaths of wildlife to remain a mystery. On top of that, this old technology would take up to 4 minutes to get a location fix. And marine animals, when they do come to the surface, it's a lot quicker than that. Shockingly, that's still the system we use today. The tracker inside this Fitbit is an old one, and it still relies on that old system. In order to get the data from this, the suction cups have to release from the whale, and it bobs around like a little pencil in the ocean. But all we know is a large area in a vast sea, which means there's this incredibly stressful time where you're trying to recover this really expensive piece of equipment containing critical information needed to protect a species or an area of ocean. But it's 2025, there's gotta be a better way, right? Well, there is, and it's called time of arrival. Time of arrival is sort of like the opposite of how GPS works in your cell phone. When you look at your GPS in your phone, it's listening for signals from satellites, it's calculating the time difference and telling you where on the planet you are. Time of arrival works the exact opposite way. Time of arrival, the tag is transmitting to the satellite. The satellite is computing where we are. And because we know the speed of light, we can calculate that position almost instantly. So what makes time of arrival so special? Well, first, tiny, lightweight trackers. Some tags can weigh less than a paperclip, allowing us to track species from birth through their entire life cycle. We also get near instant location fixes. No more waiting. Scientists can see animal movement in real time as it happens. The kicker really is we get dramatically lower costs. Traditional tags cost thousands of dollars each. Time of arrival, just a few bucks. In our tests, we've been able to shrink that spatial inaccuracy from 2 kilometers just to just a couple meters. It's changing the world of animal telemetry. Time of arrival can have significant implications for understanding things like the lifespan of sea turtles. We don't know where sea turtles go from the moment they hatch and go down a beach to when they come back to nest 10, 15 years later. It's a mystery. Baby sea turtles disappear into the ocean for a decade or more, and we don't know where they go. Tags that weigh just a gram or two can help us uncover these lost years. But this time of arrival and these smaller, lightweight tags go far beyond my work with animals. Smaller tags have significant implications for public safety. Imagine if every life jacket on a ship had a small nickel-sized tracking tag on it, kind of like an Apple AirTag, but without the need for proximity to a cell phone. Now imagine if time of arrival was everywhere. We'd be able to track all sorts of things, like a missing wallet, or a stolen car, or even your kid's mittens, not to mention what it can do for changing how we understand animal movement around the world. 8 years ago, I was stuck in traffic with a question. Can we use changing space technology to better track animal life? Today, we're doing more than tracking. We're changing how we protect the ocean, its inhabitants, and everyone who shares this planet. The ocean never stands still, but with the right technology, we can move with it. Thank you.